Dear friends, in this audio video, we are going to discuss about the liquidation. We know that the corporate debtors are admitted to corporate insolvency resolution process, and only 3% of the corporate debtors companies were resolved, whereas 97 have gone for liquidation. And the general experience is that in liquidation, you will not realize anything. And if you see the report published by Honorable Dr. Sahu in his journey to endless journey, that book, first he wrote the article, where he said that in liquidation itself, they got 1.88%. 188% of the liquidation. If you see the practical data that is published, you will realize that about 9,600 crores exposure banks gave loans to various companies, they have realized 96 crores. 9,600 crores. That means 0.1% is there. So that is why, even if you see the law, insolvency code is drafted, yes, as well as the law laid down by the Honorable NCLET, and also Supreme Court emphasis is that you should always keep the concern as a resolution, going concern and resolution. That means the company as a running company and hand over it to another good promoter. That is the intention with which the legislatures. But then, you know, we have lost lakhs of crores, and we have been discussing, and now in liquidation, this is the background. Impossible to realize more than 5% of the exposure, assets value, whatever it is. But I will give you an example, a life situation where I was the liquidator and I was able to recover 100% of the dues to the bank, public sector bank. Principal, interest, penalties, everything was recovered to that particular bank. And this experience will show you how difficult the job was. But then it is because of the commitment of the financial creditor, because of the commitment of the, I don't take any credit, I work with them as a team. And the deputy general manager, now she is the general manager, madam. And I don't want to mention, but since it's an achievement, it is to be recognized, Asha Rajiv. And that madam, I'll show you how we dealt with the subject matter team and what is the role played by me. At the same time, I would like to keep this as a lesson for liquidators, the due process procedures that has to be followed. Complete those of you who are just liquidators appointed right now, but you are searching for the regulations and all. I would like to explain to you in much details this subject. And now, what is the background to this company? The corporate debtor is a very, very famous brand name, almost 60 years old organization. And in Chennai, it is a brand name. Everybody would like to buy goods from that. It's a household item. And they have started the business, expanded to hotels. Several branches were made. Very normal business, because once you have a brand name and location, all the operational creditors, they will supply the goods and wait for you to sell them, and after 3 months, you will pay them. So That means it is a cash and carry business. It is a cash and carry. Capital is generated. Capital is generated just like that. There is no need. But this is a banker's main lead bankers have lent a lot of money. It's all in stock. Again, we are now talking about the positive side of the, because we achieved the result. And so these promoters' sons and all, there is some dispute. And but actually, you know, all the promoters before the insolvency code came in, they were using the bank's funds as income. They will not repay. They will never repay the things. When they are in trouble, they'll take another loan, buy lands, invest them, etc. So this is what everybody is doing. That's how they've grown. And their nexus is their bankers and the chairmen. They become very close. And this background, the matter was going on. Somehow, the total four bankers are there, three public sector banks and one is the private bank. And the mat was admitted and then IRP was appointed. And the same IRP was appointed as the RP. And first point, let us take. Two things you can observe in this for IBBI, because they don't take any action. No. What happened is, this gentleman was already the IRP Kamarki, a very talented person. In fact, in one of the other cases he was doing, he was the first person to get up to move the court and get the police protection. That is the first step. Police protection under IBC code for vacating the property, cooperation. From the non-cooperative corporate debtors. He was already having about 10 or 20 assignments. And then this assignment was offered. And in the assignment, a remuneration he quoted the lowest, I think 60,000. It's almost an exposure of 100 crores. And the business they are doing, they have achieved a business of 200 to 320 crores. And for that to resolving this company was paid 60,000. It was L1. And in this juncture, two important points comes to light. One is, this gentleman is having already 10 to 20 assignments. And how can he do any, it is not possible. An RP, individual, not a professional entity, cannot do more than 3 to 4. Is my 3-4 itself is very high. Maybe 3 RPs or 3 liquidations. You may have a staff, but then the act wants you should not delegate it on all the things they are talking. IBBA on one side says proper, nobody should outsource. How can one man do, let us say, 30 assignments? Can he do? But they did not pass any order, any law for that. See, what happens is IBBI is going on professing too many things. One of that, they say, the resolution insolvent professional should not outsource his duties. It is disciplinary. I'm thinking they're right. That is a notification circular which has no legal force. One, but okay, when you are doing passing laws, just sit here and then go pass laws because the government is fully supporting. Is it correct? Here what happened, this person already doing 20 assignments, one, and a company of 100 crores exposure bankers to recover and give it to those fellows. 60,000 per month is the fee. Suppose if he is able to recover and give in 6 months, he is getting 3,60,000 rupees. Is it a fair deal? Is it not the responsibility of the IBBI to look into it? So if you ask the question, going on, I am repeating, they are going on claiming credits. Basic law, they have not. That means there is no ground, they don't have touch with the reality. They never did any research, some data collection they are collecting, but without any basis. First part gone. So these bankers are all appointed. Whenever the private sector bank is there, they are very intelligent. They want to recover. They don't ill-treat. That is one thing. And they will work like a team. And they are very knowledgeable. Very minute details they will advise. We may not be knowing everything. Every situation is given. So therefore, you are learning. It is both of you together as a teamwork. This gentleman, I think, exactly conducted 3 COC meetings throughout this 9-month period. He didn't even apply for extension that was granted. And he's not available, that's all. The private sector bank, they wrote so many emails, he never replies. And only valuation is done, that's all. Nothing else is done. So they filed a complaint against him. And thereafter, when there is no resolution, nothing has been done. So where is the question of resolution? 1, no COC meetings, 3. And valuation is done. But he's a very knowledgeable guy. He's one of the leading personality. And he did not even put any efforts. Is there grievance of the ICSA? Sorry. The grievance of the bank, private sector bank. So, thereafter, another public sector bank, I was enrolled with them, empaneled with them. And they have asked me, will you be able to take up the liquidation? Yes, sir. And I am doing another liquidation of a real estate company at that point in time. And that real estate company, again, fraudulent, this thing, 18 months, I think now 24 months gone. Till now, litigation only. 1 rupee also we did not get. And some now, because of Honorable Prakash Kumar, we reached one stage. Lot of work with sincerity we did. Whether money comes or not, let us do something. We are going to give houses, 100 houses to people, and they will remember our name. We don't know in a table method when money will come, if at all it comes or not. Very difficult. And you have to run the organization. You have to have team. We have to keep paying salaries. We don't know who will bear it. Right. And so based on that, they gave me, because he's doing one. So 2 assignments I had. This is a very challenging assignment. The first meeting, all the bankers have come. And the proposed bank said, this man is already experienced in liquidation. No, it's a new liquidation. Started only about a year back. Because all the companies, law itself has come in 2017, effectively. And 2018 end, and now it started liquidations. Therefore, the law is emerging, everything is new. So, we have started that. They have told me ki, we will. This is the liquidation, and this is the company, and that RP did not, a natural complaint against him. Everything after that, I asked them, okay, sir, can you give us some remuneration? So I have told them that some remuneration you have to give me, and so that I can apply. Actually, because there's a lot of expenses and all. Then they said, no, we'll not give you any remuneration. It is according to table method. Then I asked them, are there any assets out there? They said, no assets. You have to, because he has, the promoter has diverted all the stocks and all, we don't have any data. You have to recover and give. If you are not willing, there are so many people out there. I was then the private sector bank, they were also the bankers in another assignment for me. Their general manager told this, Shivkumar is good. And he was very committed and does the work with sincerity. But you cannot have a person without money, any remuneration, you cannot take some person. That is what has happened, because the earlier man, very little amount, and then we lost complete. It is 12 months we have lost. If you want the money to be realized, then we should pay some. He should not go out of, he should not be a person without money. But they told me, okay, we'll not pay. It is for you. If you are interested, you please give your consent. We'll file it before the NCLT. Get you. Otherwise, you can we'll find somebody else. There are so many other people are waiting. So I thought, okay, we'll take it up. Let us see. And it will be an additional experience. Another thing is, if you are able to recover some money for the government, it will be, it amounts to helping the nation. That is what I thought. Bankers, public sector banks, they are only paying taxes for them. So, in this situation, I took it up. So, this is the next part. So, you can see, this is what is the learning experience for IBBA. They have not done anything here. This is a practical experience. Because in liquidation, bankers would have mortgaged if any assets, they will sell it themselves under Section 52. Nobody will give asset to them. Then only, I think, recently IBBA came out with the law, new liquidation regulations. Because too many companies going for liquidation, they might have thought this is better. So in this new regulations, if you see, the liquidator has to constitute a stakeholders committee. And the law has been clear. CIRP process is driven by bankers, financial creditors. Then compromise arrangement came later. It didn't come there. That is driven by NCLT. If you see the approach paper. And liquidator, liquidation is driven by liquidator under the overall supervision of the NCLT, adjudicating. This is a good law. They have done now. And there is a 2 years time limit was there. They have made it to 1 year now. I don't know what is the reason for you can never realize the assets in 1 year. And even they, maybe they want time bound. The judges will give extension. That is not a big problem right now. Now, the remuneration issue only, the points IBPA has not discussed. The approach paper, I'm also talking together everything. New regulations come this. In the approach paper, IBBA has very clearly said there was a discussion whether the RP should be continued as liquidator or should not be continued as liquidator. So the some people thought RP, if he has failed, why liquidation has come? Because the RP has failed. Therefore, that fellow should not be given. Because there must be some fellow sitting there having a view, which because practically they are devoid. What is the problem? Then the other people, some saint thing prevail, saying that how can you make him responsible? Unless there are allegations of misconduct or delinquency in the duties, then only we should not. Otherwise, RP should continue because of the experience he has gained. So that when you want time-bound resolution and liquidation is in time-bound manner, then this should be the basis is what they have thought. So ultimately, they have taken a good decision. I don't know how long they will keep it, but this is a good decision because why are you doubting an Atmi? Why are you doubting an Atmi? The profession of resolution profession is the key for the success of insolvency. So you want to, you think your child is a thief, then you want to discipline. What is the approach? Actually, that when you are dealing with professionals, that can never be the approach. But because the inexperience of the top people, I should say, that this situation, they may be delinquent people, that will be dealt. Every person cannot be delinquent. And in a great profession like this, who are chartered accountants or and other people are coming into the profession, then naturally nobody would like to risk their career. So you have to think positively. It is missing. And they have passed a law, recent new regulations. in bankruptcy proceeding, they took a stand. RP should not be interested parties. Actually, both should have been linked. By now, money would have come, but they don't know. And today I am there. I know so much about this particular company because 1 year over, 2 years coming there. And will I be in a position to recover the money from the personal guarantees or a new person? Unless I take a decision that I am not going to continue, you should not remove the person. And the law also has emerged. Actually, there is in the liquidation, it is the adjudicating authority who is going to appoint the liquidator as per Section 34. But again, bankers vote. There is no provision that RP should be continued or not. COC can take. He can take any decision, but that is an input for the adjudicating authority. And Prakash Kumar sir very beautifully analyzed several cases. He said, "You show delinquency. You don't like that doesn't mean anything. And if he's doing good work, then I should continue." And the same thing also, NCLAT has clearly said, Punjab National Bank in one case objected to the appointment of RP continuing as a liquidator. Then the Honorable NCLAT very clearly took a stand that once the liquidation comes, there is no committee of creditors. They are all just claimants. So you are like any other claimant. It is a process where assets are sold and then distributed to the as a particular order of Section 53 from the waterfall. Maybe you sell it as a going concern, Regulation 32E is there, or compromise arrangement under Section 230, subsection 6 is coming. That's all. So the law also says Section 33, if you see very clearly, the provision says maximum expiry period if you don't have any resolution clause. Liquidation goes automatically. Further to this, Section 12(3) was amended, wherein they tried to put it across that maximum period of CIRP should be completed within 330 days, including the litigation. But Honorable Supreme Court took that stand that it is not mandatory. Judicial delays should be excluded. But then Supreme Court was very mature and they said that delay should be connected to this stopping of the resolution process. But then, you know, it is a practical situation where ultimate goal is maximum realization to the creditors. So court will be lenient, but slowly law is emerging in this. But intention of legislature, law laid down by Honorable Supreme Court, all those things have been well thought of in this situation. The first part is over. And here you see again IBBI decided, now they have decided in case the liquidator appointed should prepare a list of the estimated expenses for 1 year to conduct the resolution liquidation. And all the expenses must be borne by the financial creditors, their profit sharing, voting sharing ratios. If they don't pay, Section 52 will become defunct and the assets pledged to them will become the property of the liquidation estate. Very good. It's a path breaking judgment decision they have taken. Possibly the reason is if they had done it for CIRP earlier, like what I have said, we would not have lost this much money. And bankers' accountability also need to be brought in. That is what I am fighting for. All right. And so I started the game with a good faith. And a bad experience I had with the previous financial creditors. And but still I thought positively you take a situation where let's do it duty for nation is what I took it. So in this discussion, I'm starting with the situation I have no money. For liquidation expenses, I don't have money. There are no assets under section liquidation estate for realization. But then I am supposed to do the work, right? We have taken it in good faith.
Who doesn't know?